And then we design that system to perform certain jobs so that ultimately you and I just see it as a phone call or a text or streaming our video or taking beautiful pictures of our friends and family.
Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Rhonda Franklin, Professor of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Minnesota. So Rhonda, when we're talking about wireless technology, we're hearing a lot now about 5G. Can you tell us what that means and how that will change the way we're sharing information in the future?
5G is a space in the frequency domain that allows us to incorporate more devices and also to do it in a way where people can connect with less time. People need to be able to move information faster because the files that you are moving are bigger. In the earlier days, like 1G and 2G, we were talking on the phone. And then we said, oh, it'd be great to text and talk on the phone. And then the internet came, and then we decided, oh, it'd be great to access the internet. Accessing it wasn't what was hard. It was moving information between the internet and on and off that was hard because the speed, the frequency that I could access was too slow for me to move information from one space to another space. So 5G allows us to move information more quickly between devices, and it allows us to have more people utilizing that frequency range because it just has more fundamental space. And so if you're trying to watch a video like streaming, and a lot of people are trying to do it at the same time, because we're all sharing that particular range of the frequency spectrum, things slow down because we're all trying to, it's like we're all trying to use the highway at the same time, and only so many cars can fit on the freeway. And only so many cars can go so fast on the freeway based on what service you own. So by going to 5G, which technically means going up in frequency, it means I'm expanding the size of the freeway and I'm making it big enough so that multiple people can go on the freeway at different speeds.
Can you discuss how nanotechnology plays a role in these advancements we're seeing?
So in order for us to work at higher frequencies, we have to have devices that operate fundamentally faster. I'm not talking about communication. I'm talking about any kind of electronics now. We have to have electronic devices that can operate fast enough to operate at the frequencies of interest. When you think about electronics, we have a circuit and we have a sentence. You have a subject and a predicate. So the predicate usually has nouns and adjectives and all of these things. And then there's a verb that connects those two. In circuits, we have the same thing. We have passive components, which act as nouns, and we have a verb, which is usually a transistor. In order for things to work well, we have to have transistors that operate faster. And those transistors that operate faster are usually called nanotransistors. So everything is moving to this really, really tiny device that is able to go faster and faster and faster when I ask it to operate as a verb. I need it to do two things. Transistors have primarily two jobs. They have one job to create a signal, which is called an oscillator or a clock for digital. And they have another job to turn things on and off, which is a switch. So in digital, it would be an oscillator or a switch. But in analog, which is where communications oftentimes sits, we also need transistors to make signals get bigger, called amplifiers. So without this action component, similar to an action word in a sentence, we can't create signals and we cannot manipulate those signals or make them bigger. We have to have that one device, and those devices are moving toward nanometer or subnanometer dimensions, which is nano devices. When I make the device small, I've got to get a signal in and out of it, which means what connects to it has to also be small, which means all of the interconnects, these highways that signals travel on, are nanometer size. And so we need ways for signals to propagate on these nanometer size interconnects into the devices in order to build circuits that perform all these different functions that ultimately get categorized as a phone call, a text, a video, imaging, all of these kind of physical structures that do these high-level jobs that we are more familiar with as users. On the interconnect side, it's important to know how to get signals in and out of these small transistors, but it also means that I've got to make sure that the size of the signal, meaning the energy associated with it, is suitable for the devices themselves. Because as things get smaller, you can imagine that the energy associated with these signals has to change too. Otherwise, we burn everything up if we push really big, you push really high, you know, too high of a power level into it, it just destroys the environment. But if you can match the energy level with the physical structure that that energy moves through, then you get an optimum movement of energy or signal through a system. And then we design that system to perform certain jobs so that ultimately you and I just see it as a phone call or a text or streaming our video or taking beautiful pictures of our friends and family.
What are you most excited about where you think this technology can go?
I am excited about the idea that because they're already doing the transistor. So 20 years ago, we didn't have the transistors. So we were working on all of the passive structures. Today, the transistors exist, which means now we can start building circuits. So I'm extremely excited because now that I have a verb, my group is interested in working on creating the nouns and creating all of the passive components that you need to build interesting circuits that are going to move toward terahertz. I can envision that with proper building of the fundamental building blocks for these circuits, we're now going to be able to create electronic communication systems in that space that will move us closer to the interface between communications that's based on invisible signals and communications that's based on light. That's the boundary that we're starting to traverse. I can immediately see now that we're doing video and streaming and the way we're discussing that, it wouldn't seem unreasonable for holographic and virtual reality to become something that we can do in a way that actually is feasible. And you need a lot of bandwidth for stuff like that because 3D images take up they create a lot of data.
Well, Rhonda, I have really enjoyed our conversation this afternoon, and I just want to ask, do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
What has fascinated me about nanotechnology is that I can see it in my mind, but I can see it in my mind because I understood microelectronics, and so I understood what physical dimensions were. So I think if a person really wants to understand the realm of what's possible, it's going to be very important to really think about the dimension that, what does dimension mean? And how does the way we think about design change when I have this opportunity to use dimensionality as a design element for advancing technology? And that's probably kind of an obscure thought, but that's really where the crux of being able to see where the future is in how we use the design elements of nano. Nanotechnology is bringing a lot of different people together. And I think if you can see how we're bringing things together, then you can think about communications, but you can also think about communicating to cells, communicating to biology, and using the ideas behind communication to create a physical construct that allows communication to occur, even though it may not be exactly the way we understand or build things today. But that particular technology to me is the interface to this new dimension of how we can think of communications in the future.